Hello, welcome back. So, this is the second lecture on the on relative performance evaluation, and today we are going to consider a different form of a contract, which is called a tournament. So, what is tournament? So, when you hear this word tournament, you may think like there is some sort of sports competition where there is some sort of round of 16, and then semi-final and quarter-final, quarter-final and then semi-final and the final, and then in the final round the winner is selected. That sort of thing is tournament, right? But here we are going to use this word tournament in a different way. So here what we mean by tournament is this. It is basically some sort of contest, some sort of the competition for a prize. So there is a prize and multiple participants are competing to win the prize. Okay, so in this context, tournament is just some sort of competition. There is no round of 16 or quarterfinal or semifinal, etc., etc. So there is just one shot game, but there is direct competition. So that's the difference between this form of contract tournament and the contract that we just considered in the previous lecture. So before we move on, so let me just refresh your memory about the contract that we considered in the previous lecture, which we may call it which we may call a linear contract. So there, the wage function was linear in the performance measures xi and xj, and that will not be the case in this tournament. So in the linear contract, there was no direct competition between the players, between the workers, because how can you tell that? You can tell that, you can see it by looking at the best response function of the agent, best response function of the worker. So the best response function of the worker was like A equals S over C, right? So S was the marginal payment and C is the marginal cost, some sort of marginal cost, right? So it doesn't depend on the effort level of others. But here in tournament, we'll see a direct competition. How can you tell that? We can see it by just looking at the best response function of the agent. If you look at the best response function of the agent, if my best effort depends on my optimal effort depends on others' effort, then that means there is direct competition. Because if others, what that means is, if others put more effort, then it is my best interest to increase my effort as well. So there is direct and strategic interaction among the workers, among the players. So in that case, we say that okay, there is a direct competition among the workers or the participants, competitors. Okay, so that's what we are going to see in this contract. Okay, so here we go. So there are two risk neutral agents with reservation payoff zero. The reservation payoff is not really important, so we just set it at zero. And we are considering two risk neutral agents. That means there is no tension between insurance and incentives. Then you may wonder why we don't consider the tension between insurance and incentive, because you know the whole point of using RPE, the relative performance evaluation, is to reduce to mitigate the tension between insurance and incentive. And if we start from the assumption that there is no tension between insurance and incentive, then we will not see the effect of using this relative performance evaluation, right? But I still want to use this assumption, the you know the risk neutrality assumption, because it makes our life much easier. It makes the formulas much simpler, and you know, analysis simpler. So I'll just keep this assumption, and later I'll discuss what will happen if the agents are risk averse. So if the agents are risk averse, then there must be some tension between insurance and incentive. Then we can guess, we can imagine that this form of contract, this RPE, has some bite. But with this assumption, the risk neutrality assumption, there is no point of using RPE. But still, the reason why I want to discuss this form of contract is just to show that this linear contract is not the only form of RPE. As a matter of fact, tournament is more relevant form of RPE. It's used more widely in reality. So probably you have seen similar form of contract, similar form of arrangement, institution in reality. So you may have seen this form of contract, and what I want to say is it is a form of RPE, okay, relative performance evaluation. And then later I will discuss why we are using this kind of institution. Okay, let's get started. So the performance measure is same as before. So xi equals ai plus epsilon I plus alpha times epsilon j. And epsilon I follows some function. It doesn't have to be normal distribution, but it follows some distribution f. And f must be some continuous differentiable function. And epsilon I and epsilon j are independent. So that's our assumption. And this is the description about the tournament, the form of contract. The agent with the higher output gets a fixed wage T plus a prize W, while the agent with lower output gets only the fixed payment T. Okay, so the agent's payoff must look like this: T plus probability of winning times the value of prize minus the effort cost. Because the agents are risk neutral, there is no concavity in the utility function, you know, other than the cost function. So it is just simply a sum of the fixed payment T plus the probability of winning times the value of prize. So that's the expected payoff, right? That's the expected monetary payoff, because if you win, so you're agent I, and if you win, that means xi is greater than xj. So if xi is greater than xj, that means your performance is better than the other. So then you win, and you will get this prize, and the value of prize is W. So this is the expected payoff. So you may want to maximize this by choosing right A. Then how do you do that? So that's the point. So that's the question that we want to discuss. So again, tournament is a form of RPE, and for a RPE to improve efficiency, we need these assumptions. The agents must be risk averse. So if agents are risk neutral, then there is no tension between insurance and incentive. That means there is no point of using RPE. But if the agents are risk averse, then there is the tension. And if you use RPE, then you can somehow improve the contract. And another assumption, another condition is alpha to be greater than 0. What does that mean? So what is alpha? Alpha is here. So in the performance measure XI, there is alpha. So if alpha is greater than 0, that means there is some positive correlation between the performance, the noises in the performance measures. So what that means, in other words, what that means is the there is some sort of a common unobserved factor, like common shock or common thing, like the difficulty of exam or the economic condition, macroeconomic conditions, something like that. So if alpha is greater than 0, then there is some sort of common unobserved factor, and by using RPE, we can somehow reduce the variance of the noise by eliminating this common factor. Right? So that's the idea of RPE, and this tournament is a form of RPE. So for this tournament to improve efficiency from the linear contract, or sorry, not linear contract, so some sort of individual contract, then we must assume these two things. There are two conditions. First, the agents must be risk-averse, and second, there must be some sort of a common unobserved factor. Right? But we don't consider that. I mean, we don't. We are assuming that the agents are risk-neutral. So we will now see how exactly this tournament is improving the efficiency. But still, I want to keep this assumption that the agents are risk-neutral, because that makes our life much easier. Right? And the point of our discussion today is that I just want to present a different. I just want to introduce a different form of contract, which is called a tournament. And this tournament is used in many situations in reality, including job promotion, sports games, R&D competition, government procurement, etc., etc. So it's used a lot in reality, and it's a form of RPE. So it's good to know. Okay, so let's just consider the problem, agent's problem. So we want to maximize the agent's expected utility, but there is this probability function in the expected utility function. So let's just consider that part. So the probability of winning is the probability that Xi is greater than Xj. So let's just spell them out. Then Xi is ai plus epsilon i plus alpha times epsilon j, and Xj is aj plus epsilon j plus alpha times epsilon i. And then we move the terms, like we move aj to the left, and epsilon i minus epsilon i plus alpha times epsilon j to the right, and then we can write the we can see that now there is a random variable on the right. So on the left-hand side of the inequality, there is ai minus aj. These are not random variables. These are some numbers. These are not random variables. On the right-hand side, there is a random variable. So random variable minus random variable is a random variable. So epsilon j minus epsilon i is a random variable. And if you multiply some number to it, it's still a random variable. So 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon i is a random variable. And we just regard it as a new random variable. You may want to call it, I don't know, some zeta, anything. You may call it zeta. Okay, so there is a Now we have a new random variable on the right-hand side of the inequality, which is 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon I. And now at the last line, we have h, and large h is the cumulative distribution function of this new random variable, 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon I. And we are going to assume that this h is a nice function, is a continuous differentiable nice function. Okay? So then, we have this, right? So the now and there is one observation about this new random variable 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon I. So as alpha goes to 1, this 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon I goes to 0. More precisely, the variance of it shrinks down to 0. What that means is basically there, if what does that mean, alpha equals 1? If alpha equals 1, then the noise is the same. So these two noises are same. So basically, they are subject to these performance measures xi and xj are subject to the same, exactly same noises. So by comparing them, we can basically eliminate these noises, right? So by comparing xi and xj, the principal can figure out the difference in the effort. The principal can eliminate the noise, and the principal can figure out the difference in the effort. Then what matters will be just the effort. If you work slightly more, if you put slightly more effort, then you win. Okay, so there is no noise, there is no randomness if alpha is 1, right? You can see that here. So if alpha is 1, or is as alpha goes to 1, the variance of this new random variable 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon j, sorry, epsilon I, shrinks down to 0. So that means there is no asymmetric information problem between the principal and the agent. Okay? So, using this notion, of H, the cumulative distribution function, we can derive the first order condition of the agent's utility maximization problem. And by solving this problem, you can get this equation on the top. The equilibrium effort level is characterized by this equation, W times small h of 0 minus c prime of a equals 0, where small h is the density function, probability density function of this new random variable 1 minus alpha times epsilon j minus epsilon I. So how do you get this? So first, you differentiate the objective function of the agent I, right? So we are looking at this objective function, the utility function, expected utility function of the agent, which is t plus w times h of ai minus aj minus c of ai. So previously, there was this probability function. So h is basically the probability of winning. But now, we can see just some function h, differentiable function. So you can differentiate this function with respect to ai. Then you'll have the first derivative of this expected utility function, and then you set the derivative to 0 to get this first order condition. So which reads W times h of ai minus aj minus c prime of ai equals 0. So this is the first condition. And at the same time, we can call it the best response function of the agent I. So this shows, this equation characterize the optimal response, the best response of agent I in response to what? In response to the effort of the agent J. So here you can see okay, so this is the implicit function, so you don't see it very clearly, but if you solve this equation for AI, then it will be a function of AJ, right? So what that means is this equation shows how the agent I must respond to agent J's effort. So it's a function of AJ. What that means is there is a direct competition between AI and AJ. Let's look at the diagram on the right. So if AI increases, then the optimal AJ increases. What that means is if my rival puts more effort, then I may want to put more effort as well. So that sort of story is going on here. So there is direct competition in this contract, in tournament. But in contrast, in linear contract that we saw in the previous lecture, there was no direct competition. So in the linear contract, the optimal effort level was just S over C. What is S over C? S is the marginal payment and C is the cost parameter. So it's not a function of AJ. So it doesn't matter what the other's effort is. What matters is my marginal payment, S. But that's not the case here. In tournament, my optimal effort depends on my rival's effort. You can see it in this equation, the best response function, or in the diagram, right? And we'll impose symmetry. That's the last step. The last step is we are imposing symmetry. So what that means is we set AI equals AJ. Why is that case? Because these two agents are symmetric, identical in every aspect. So what that means is their utility functions are symmetric, so their best response functions must be symmetric. So if there are two best response functions, symmetric best response functions, they must intersect each other on the 45 degree line, right? So look at the diagram. They must intersect each other at the 45 degree line. What that means is when they cross each other, AI must be AJ. So we impose AI equals MJ, and then we have the equation on the top. W times small h of 0 minus C of A equals 0. So this is the equation that characterizes the optimal effort, right? So it's a function of W. So the optimal effort is determined by this W. So by choosing the right W, the value of price, the principal can change the effort level, right? So that's the idea. So the principal will optimally choose TNW, large W, to implement the optimal effort. So what is the optimal effort? First, we need to figure out what is the optimal effort. As written in the slide, the first best effort, or the socially optimal level of effort, is characterized by this equation. 1 equals C prime A, C prime of A. So why is this case? The social surplus can be written like this. x1 minus w1 plus x2 minus w2. So this is the social surplus, and by imposing the binding IR constraint, we can rewrite the social surplus or the expected profit like this. So it is a1 plus a2 minus 2t minus large w. So why is this the case? So there are two agents, and each agent gets a fixed payment t. So the principal must pay 2t, and there is this the principal also has to pay the price. So there is this w. And then we impose the binding IR constraint, then we have the less line. In the less line, you see a1 plus a2 minus c of a1 minus c of a2. So this is the social surplus, and this is the expected profit of the principal. Why are they same? I mean, the social surplus and the expected profit of the principal, because the principal, so the binding IR constraint means that the agents get zero surplus, because we are assuming the reservation payoff is zero. So the agents get zero surplus, that means the principal gets the entire surplus, that means the social surplus is same with the principal's expected profit. So the principal's expected profit is same as the social surplus, which is a1 minus c of a1 plus a2 minus c of a2. So that is very intuitive, right? So a1 is the surplus generated by the effort, and c of a1 is the cost, and a2 is the value of effort, value created by the agent, and C of A2 is the effort cost. So this is the social surplus. If you maximize this social surplus by choosing A1 and A2, then you can easily see that the first best effort level, the first best effort must be characterized by the equation on the top, 1 equals C prime of A1, sorry, A. So what is this? 1 is the marginal benefit of putting 1 unit of effort. Okay, so if you put 1 unit of effort, then 1 unit of value is created. Right, so it's linearly, so the value is linearly increasing in effort. So you can see that in A1 or A2. In the social surplus equation, right? In the social surplus equation, we have a1 plus a2. That means if you put 1 unit of effort, then the value value increases by 1 unit. And so 1 is the marginal benefit, and c prime is the marginal cost. So marginal benefit equals marginal cost. So that's the condition for the optimal, that's the condition for maximization, the maximization of the social surplus. So, in the first best situation, the marginal benefit of effort must be same as the marginal cost of the effort. Then, how can we implement this? How can we achieve this level of effort? Answer is this: by setting w equals 1 over h of 0, the principal can achieve the first best effort level. So the idea is the equilibrium effort level is characterized by w times h of 0 equals c prime of a. You can see the you see this equation on the line on the third line from the bottom. So W times H of 0 equals C prime of A. So this is the equilibrium effort. And we want to make this equation same with the equation on the right, 1 equals C prime of A. Then how is that possible? We set W equals 1 over H of 0. Then these two equations would look exactly the same. That means the principle can achieve the first best effort level. So the principle can implement the first best effort level. This shouldn't be too surprising because the agents are risk neutral, and as I said before, if the agents are risk neutral, there is no tension between insurance and incentive. So the first best effort level can be achieved even in the simple individual contract. So this is not surprising. So there is no improvement by the relative performance evaluation. But I just wanted to, as I said, show you that there is a different form of contract, and this form of contract is used a lot in reality. And I just want to show how it works. Next, I want to discuss the benefit of it. So there are two conditions for RPE to improve efficiency. The first is the agents must be risk averse. So then there is the tension between insurance and incentive, and alpha must be greater than zero. Then that means there is a there is some sort of common shock or common unobserved factor. Then by eliminating this common unobserved factor, the RPE can improve efficiency of the contract. If these two conditions hold, then a tournament can generate a bigger surplus than any payment scheme based only on individual performances. Okay. Again, the reason is the principal can provide a better insurance to the agent. Then the agents are more willing to accept the risky contract. Then the principal can provide a stronger incentive as well. Overall, the efficiency is improved by the RPE. Okay, so I guess that's it for today. Next time I will discuss a different topic. Alright, thanks. Bye.